Hello lads.
And me ladies.
And welcome back in the workshop. Today we are playing with switches. Now these switches are pretty much the simplest thing you can imagine. They are plain buttons. Either they are pressed or unpressed. And that's all. But we are gonna use them here today for something cool.
Limit switches, bitch.
But then again, isn't almost everything made out of plain switches? Isn't the world an awesome place?
Everybody knows the rocket man. Said that everybody knows the rocket man. When he floats into outer space.
Okay, I'm stopping this. They are for the CNC machine. Now, when you're working with a CNC machine, everything is relative. Most of the time. And forgive me if you already know what I'm gonna talk about here, but I believe that there are fellas out there who don't. After all, no one can know everything. Now, what I mean by relative. If you have a look here, my spindle is right in this location. And my machine is homed. X, Y, and Z are all zero. So this location is called home as far as the machine knows, where all three axes are at zero. And now let me move that a bit. I moved all three axes one by one, and my spindle now sits above this spot, approximately, which is X minus 45, Y minus 79, and Z 14. Those numbers are in millimeters in my case, and they are all relative to our previous home position back there. So if I move them all until they are all back at zero again, we will be in the exact same spot where we started. But what happens if I reboot the machine? We are back at zero, which means this spot is now our new home. Which means that if I tell the machine again to go on X minus 39, Y minus 73 and whatever, this would be a whole new spot down here somewhere. Then if I reboot, down here will be our new home. Well, you get that. Now let's say for a moment that you want to mill just a square. So you need a piece of G-code. You go to your favorite appropriate software and you design your CAD, a square. Then you go to CAM to generate your toolpaths. And there, 9 out of 10 times, you are called to set your origin. Your origin is your starting point, your home point, let's call it. So you could go and set your origin at the center of your design. Then you could place your tool right on the center of where you want your square to be. Make sure everything is at zero and hit the run button. Your machine would raise a bit and most likely go for a corner. It would plunge there and move around to give you your square. But you could place your origin wherever you like. 9 out of 10 I like to go for the bottom left corner of my design. In that case I would place my tool there instead of there, zero everything and hit the button. My tool would plunge right on the spot and make the movement to give me the same square that you got at the very same place that you got it. But notice here that my piece of code in this case lacks this movement. The very first movement of your code. So if you gave me your code without saying a thing, and I assumed that you think the same way as I do, I would place my tool here to get a square where this is. But instead of that, I would get only half a square right there. So as you understand, G-code is also a relative thing. And here we are talking relativity of relativity, which personally is a thing I like. Let's say that I wanted to mill this thing, and given that my origin is at the bottom left corner of my design, which is about there. Now I could place my stock there, or 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 there, and every time I would get the same result. Given that every time I would home my tool right at this spot of my material, like this. and my machine would give me what I wanted while having no clue where exactly it is working relatively to the machine itself, the physical boundaries I mean. I could even place that sideways and swap my X and Y motor connectors back on the ramp shield if I was too lazy to make a new piece of G-code for sideways milling. Each time I would get my result.
Okay, Zip, everything is awesome, birds are singing and blossoms are blooming. But what gives? Why do you have them switches on your bench? Well, let me tell you right away.
When you are used in operating your CNC machine like me, making it work for you without knowing where it is, there is one and only one drawback. Guess what? It doesn't know where it is. Let's say that you want to make something bigger, like this or this. And now we're gonna go with Kitheblom. This one. And you place your stock right there and you home your machine with your tool at the bottom left corner of that, where your origin is. And you start carving the sucker. But guess what? You forgot to actually set your origin when making your G-code, and instead of being down here, where we all thought was the case, it is now up there. Let's say top mid spot of your stock. These things can happen. You wasn't paying too much attention, you were thinking of your lady making you steaks while in her underwear, I don't know. Generating G-code can get a boring job sometimes, and your mind is drifting. So what will happen now? Your tool, which is starting from here and was supposed to move that way, will now want to go work in a whole different spot, somewhere here, which is well outside your physical boundaries. And either you realize that soon enough and abort everything, hit the red button or pull a plug out or something, or you are kinda screwed. This carriage here would go hit this wall and our table would hit the back of our machine there. And this specific machine, which is stiff enough, belt driven and uses some rather small NEMA 17s, I believe has not got the power to destroy itself. Actually, it was supposed to spend its life in a university. But my other one back there, the first one I made, uses threaded rods to move everything, which of course cannot jump on a pulley, and something would give. And now you must be thinking, okay lad, I will just be extra cautious when making my code, and I will be golden. Good for you. No stock going wasted. But there are other things. Ο διάβολος έχει πολλά ποδαριά. It is a saying we have here in Greece, which literally means the devil has many legs. Something like a centipede. I don't know. What I'm trying to say here is that even if you never mess with your origin, there are other things that could drive your machine crashing. Like forgetting to home it, not zeroing everything. Or using the wrong post-processor. This could make your CNC doing unpredictable stuff. I have been there. But using these switches here, you can make your machine knowing exactly where it stands anytime, and prevent it from trying to travel beyond its maximum travel. Now, the way this is done is quite simple. You take one of your switches, you place it right about here, and you wire it to your controller back there. This is my x-axis. So when my x-axis carriage travels up to this point, the switch is pressed, and the controller knows that X cannot travel anymore to the left in this case. X minus direction. So this is called a limit switch, or an end stop. And it also serves another purpose. My machine now not only was saved from the grass, but it also knows that this carriage here is at the furthest possible location to the left. And this gives me some great opportunity. I can now enable a homing cycle. This meaning that whenever I power up this machine, it will move the X axis this way until it hits the switch, and set my X axis to zero. So for the other end of this axis, I could wire another switch to prevent it from crashing, which would also be a hardware end stop, since they are using real hardware. Or I could just set a software end stop if having my homing cycle enabled. This means that I could let my software know that the maximum travel of this axis is 30 cm, and having determined where this carriage is using our first switch here, it could never allow it to travel in the opposite direction for a distance greater than its max travel. This is called a software end stop. But the list of opportunity doesn't really stop here. Saving you 50 pounds on switches and wires isn't the greatest thing this can do. Let's say that you want to do two-sided milling. Make something like this coin. This would require at least two separate operations, one for each side. But you would also want them to be completely aligned, X and Y. And you could definitely do that without a homing cycle if you are a pervert like me and enjoy making precision measurements, but using such a system could make it as simple as just flipping your stock. Same goes with one-sided operations that require more than one passes. This is the flower we made here together when talking about making reliefs. I mean, it is the same design. Actually, those are much older and I made them on my other machine with a trial version of Artcam, long before they discontinued that. I think I made those in just one operation back then, but picture that we wanted this in a much bigger scale. Doing that with one toolpath would take a whole life. What you really want here is to use two toolpaths, each one using a different tool. The first one would make a rough shape of your flower, but it could remove a big amount of material in a small period of time. And the second one would use a carving tool to make all the details. And guess what? They would also have to be completely aligned. Again, there are other ways of achieving that. I like to make a mark outside my piece for my origin and offset my machine by this distance. This leaves my mark nice and sound. But using those, piece of cake. And of course, there is this other scenario, maybe the biggest of them all, power losses. Now, unless you are a big fabricator who runs his machines on UPSs and stuff like that, a momentary power loss can screw you quite hard. Imagine you are an hour or two into some big project and the power goes out. Imagine it is even on some expensive stock. If having your work area somehow correlated to your machine's bed, you can catch up with that. If not, sorry buddy, I know how that feels. So even though I really enjoy my freedom there and all the relativity babushkas, those things can offer some great value. And also some of you asked for a video on endstops. So I will give them a try. But, you know, I am talking for quite some time and your brain is probably rejecting my voice by now. And we haven't even talked about electromagnetic interference yet. Not to mention setting loose. So this is gonna be all for today, folks. And I will see you next time when we wire them and give them a try. Until then, have a nice one.